today for his talk on the impact of work in an age of uncertainty. Certainly is an age of uncertainty. Dr. Bluestein is a very interesting guy who is, I think, not afraid of disciplinary boundaries and has found himself in counseling, developmental, and educational psychology. And has been there since 2001, isn't it?
Well, 1999.
1999.
Yeah, I just don't.
2 years, even longer. And has been very prolific in publishing about work and was actually in, I think, your 2006 book on the psychology of working, really had a major impact, I think, on the field and really understanding work and influence of work on people's lives and their psychological health and well-being, and really helping, I think, IO psychology to kind of take another look at the way we understand individual behavior in organizations. Anyway, I can go over a number of his accolades, but you can just rest assured that there's quite a few of them. And I'd rather give the time today to his talking about this most recent project, which I think we're getting a preview of, coming out soon, right? Mm-hmm. Next year. And with that, no further ado, back to Bluestein.
Thank you. Thank you, Ruth, and thank you, your colleagues, for inviting me here. It's a really great honor to be here. I'm very excited to be here. I also want to give a particular thank you to Julie Anstis, who's here, who was one of my students at Albany. We've known each other since 1986, and it's a great honor for me to see her in this very important position, which she so richly deserves. So I really thank you for being here, and seeing you here makes it feel like home to me. So I'm going to speak about a book which I am literally about 2 working days away from being able to send it to the publisher. I have about 8 pages left. And it's frustrating not to be able to get those days, but I will get them certainly before Christmas. So this is a book project I've been working on for about 5 years. It seems to be the average amount of time it takes me to write a book, but hopefully this will be. This is the first full presentation I'm giving on this book. So it's a kind of world premiere here, where I've written all the chapters now, and I have a good sense of what's in here, and I'm really looking forward to seeing your feedback on it. So the book is called The Impact of Work in an Age of Uncertainty. It'll be published by Oxford University Press. Depending on what the revisions look like, it could be anywhere from, hey, this is great, here's a few edits, to what I am afraid of will be massive revisions. I don't want that word massive being used. But the editors, and actually I had the vision that I wanted to write a book that would have a broader impact, that would impact, would not be a popular book per se, although I wouldn't mind if the book is popular, but it's a book written for what they call it, a crossover book that will have an academic appeal as well as an appeal to interested readers about work writ large. So let me set the stage for this project. Why did I do this at this point in time? What do we hope to learn? I'm trained as a counseling psychologist. I'm actually a vocational psychologist, a specialty within counseling psychology. And I'm somebody asked me today about how I got into this field. I forgot who it was. With great conversations with many of the people here. It was, some ways, it was a calling for me to get into this field. And that calling got fine-tuned over the years. And when Julie was a student in our program, I was more of a traditional career development scholar. And somehow, toward the mid to late 90s, I started to shift. I had a real paradigm shift in my own mind. And I moved into what I thought would become a more transformative discourse, in some ways a disruptive discourse in my field. I felt like our field of vocational psychology needed to be disrupted. It had a history of being very effective, but very effective for a circumscribed array of populations and problems. So my hope was to kind of shift the gears of the field, a little bit ambitious of hope, but I felt, as I said, some calling to do it. So this project was written as a way to really map what is the experience of work like in this point in time in the United States. Some people will say, well, the book doesn't have international appeal. Good point. Hard enough to write a book of this nature about a place as diverse as the US. If I were to try to write a book like this for the Globe, I would never be done with it. I would encourage other scholars who are interested in this to take these ideas, take this paradigm, and use it and see what we can locate as we really dig deep into other communities. So what I want to talk about here are some of the, give you a tour of the contents of this book. I will talk about the methods, the methodology I use. I'll give you a tour of the content, and I will talk about the implications for both for psychological practice, which I'm considering here, again, broadly, because I'm not speaking to therapists and counseling or clinical psychologists. I'm speaking to mostly IO, human engineering psychologists. These are the people I spoke to today. And I'll also talk about implications for policy. So I'm going to put up a number of quotes, because this is a book based on 61 in-depth interviews. This one is pretty amazing. David, you don't look well. Some of them I'll read, some of them I'll let you read, but this one I feel like I need to read. It was the end of a cold, gloomy January day spent interviewing people about their work lives for this book at a one-stop career center in downtown Boston, one of the many government-funded agencies across the United States for job hunters. I was a bit surprised that my face gave away my feelings so vividly. My final participant for the day had picked up on the fact that I was drained, sad, angry, and overwhelmed after listening to how people's lives had fallen apart in the shadows of the Great Recession. Even for someone like me who helps people navigate their working lives for a living, I felt heartbroken when hearing about how people's lives had fallen apart as their work options diminished or disappeared. So these are true vignettes I'm sharing with you. In collecting the data for this, I did a fair number of the interviews myself. We did go down to the local one-stop career center and we interviewed people there. And I will tell you that these experiences were emotionally overwhelming for me and for my students. So let me give you a little bit of a story. I kind of talked a little bit about my journey from a traditional career development scholar to the psychology of working. I'll just give you a little bit more depth on that. I had a series of insights in the 90s with some concerns about how I could take whatever talents I had, which one's never quite sure of, and use them for maximal good in the world. And I really felt like the needs that existed were not so much with the middle class populations, the college students, but they were really with the people who we had conceived of as being on the margins, but really in many ways statistically are the mainstream of our population. People without college degrees, people working in what we now call precarious work. So my goal was to explore the psychological impact of work from an experiencer perspective, which involves for me using qualitative research, not necessarily always, but some part of my work has really been focusing on that. And I also felt like I wanted the participants from this study to inform the future debates. You'll see at the end of this, I'm going to be giving advice on issues around economics and public policy. And I anticipate people in audiences and readers saying, what does he know about this? I've never even took an economics course. I wanted to. I went in there for the first 2 days, and I left. Where's my colleague from Stony Brook, who went to Stony Brook also, your department chair? He was at Stony Brook, he was a doc student, I was an undergrad. I was in an economics course for 2 days and I left. I think I thought I couldn't get an A in the course. This isn't going to be an easy class. And I was also, you know, an anti-war activist, and I said, what am I taking economics for? I should have taken the course, I should have taken others. But I have become a student of economics over the years, as I'm sure many of us have. So, why this project now? Ruth and I were chatting earlier, the timing for this has never been greater. The world of work is changing rapidly. There's been a tremendous rise in precarious work. Precarious work is a term that's really much more popular in Europe than it is here. It refers to unstable work, short-term work, contract work. There was a recent study by two economists in 2016, Katz and Kruger, that documented that many of the new job gains made since 2007 were in short-term contract work, which we now know is precarious work. Growing levels of instability at work, increases in the length and impact of long-term unemployment. If you look at this data on long-term unemployment, it's sobering. In 1990, the percentage of people who were unemployed for a year or more was, I believe, about 16%. Now it's about 25%. So an increase, more than double the people who are long-term unemployed have been, in comparison to 30 years ago, have been unemployed for a long time. So the unemployment rate over the years had often been considered as people churning through the labor market. That's a term the economists have used. People out of work for a few months, getting new work. Situation is very different right now. Deindustrialization, which is related to what I call the growth in ill-informed solutions to the problems about work insecurity. I will speak a little bit about politics here. The people who supported Trump and supported populist movements, some of whom voted, we don't know all the reasons why they voted the way they did. Some people might be here and they might have very interesting perspectives and, you know, a good rationale. Some of these causes are linked to the instability in the workforce. I think most scholars would agree, most policy analysts would agree. Another problem is there's a reliance on macro level aggregate data in our policy decisions about work. It's almost all based on economics data, and which is not bad data, it's good data, but we are missing out on very important insights. So what do we hope to learn from this study? What is the inner experience of work at this point in our country's history? How does work affect people, their families, and their communities? What do people need to manage their lives at work? This is one of the inferences I've just been working on in the last few months. And what do policymakers and employers need to do to create humane, dignified, and decent work? So the methods and processes, we collected a large qualitative data set here. Those of you who do qualitative research know that typically the samples are not that large. I decided to collect a larger data set. I felt like this was an important study. I wanted a lot of depth, and I wanted a lot of range in the sample. We used purposive sampling, and we basically used the snowball method. My students would come up with people we knew. I tried to make it as geographically diverse because we attract students from all over the US. I have colleagues. I posted notices on LinkedIn. I posted notices on other social media. And we ended up getting a very diverse sample, very diverse in almost every possible way, race, gender, socioeconomic status, et cetera. I did come up with an a priori kind of coding template based on my views about the ways in which work can help us be alive in the world. And that was kind of like the underlying thesis of this book, that working when it's going well can help us really feel a sense of aliveness in the world. And that's one of the things that is curtailed or lost when working is not available. So we had a kind of rudimentary coding template. And then a more in-depth coding process was used, which actually formed the structure of each chapter. And in this sense, the participants helped to provide the content of the chapter, of each of these chapters that I'm going to talk about. The methodology was a kind of an amalgam of a narrative approach, which is based on the idea of looking at the person's entire life history, looking at their life story. And we did that by reading carefully. I read carefully at each interview. And then we did a content analysis. And we did that looking at first the major codes for the chapters and then the subcodes within each chapter. And I used both qualitative kind of postmodern approach of looking at the nature of these themes, but I also was a bit of a post-positivist in looking at the frequency. I reported on the themes that were the most prominent, which is consistent with another approach that's popular in our field, consensual qualitative research. So I used kind of an amalgam of qualitative methods here. The interview process, we actually worked on the interview and then made changes on the interview throughout the time of the data collection. These are the main themes. We ask participants to tell us the story of their lives. We ask them about their relationships, their family lives, their hopes, their dreams, their perspectives on the American dream, their sources of frustration and joy, and recommendations for the creation and sustenance of dignified work. I did not use all of the data we collected in this book. Three or four other projects are percolating out of my research team now on different subsets of these data, and these are being led primarily by my students. So the guiding assumptions come from The Psychology of Working. The 2006 book is the more popular one. I'm trying to publicize my 2013 Oxford handbook, so that's the one I put in here. Plus, it's a very cool cover. I say so myself, the cover is great. The book may not be as good as the cover, but it was a good book. So in this Psychology of Working framework, I talked about working having the potential to fulfill three fundamental needs. And other people have developed other taxonomies of the needs of work fulfills. Maria Yehuda, and other people over the years. I just thought this was a good kind of concise taxonomy. Survival, relatedness, and self-determination. And I'll be coming back to these. So another guiding assumption is that working when it's going well helps us to feel fully alive in the world. Julie knows I'm a big rock music fan, and Julie asked me if I was going to use any Bruce Springsteen quotes in this, which I did use in my first book. I got a little pushback on that from colleagues. They couldn't get it, but I did, plus there were some issues paying for those things. I had to get money. It was complicated. He's a great guy from what I understand. His law office wasn't good on permissions. Very, very unfair system in my opinion. But anyway, so over the years, gone to my share of Bruce Springsteen concerts, and one of the questions that he used to raise, is there anybody out there who's really alive? Very interesting question. It's a very deep question, really. And the way I understood it was, are you really living life in a way that's the way you want to live it? Are you feeling the energy and passion of life? And I feel like working when it goes well helps us to feel really alive. It's also full of frustrations and aggravation. I had 61 emails to answer on Monday. I was not happy about that. But this issue of aliveness I felt was really important, particularly in relation to the changes in the workforce, particularly in relation to entering a period where work is going to become more and more unstable, where the people will be moving in and out of marketplace work. What's this going to be like in our lives? As psychologists, as scholars, as citizens, as family members. So working from a psychological perspective is essential to our well-being and essential to the welfare of communities and societies, although I think I was telling Howard earlier that when I've written this up, I have students who always say, I'll be happy not to work. I don't need to work. Just give me my basic income guarantee. And I think when I tell them, I said, that's all well and good if it's the spring or the summer. See what it's like in February. We have nowhere to go, it's raining, it's snowing, it's cloudy, there's about 6 hours of daylight in Boston. See how you like it. So these are the chapters, which I did organize before I started writing. And I'm gonna go over aspects from each of these chapters. That working gives us a sense of being alive, being able to, some of these you can see from the original Psychology of Working framework. Some of these are new additions. Being part of something bigger than ourselves, being motivated, being the best we can be, being able to care, being able to work without oppression and harassment, being without work, and then my final chapter, being able to work with dignity and opportunity. So in the first chapter, I outlined history of work. It was a kind of real introduction to the Sydney sets of issues. And I focused on this issue of the centrality of work in people's lives. And in some ways, the centrality of work was one of the cohering themes across these 61 interviews. And again, this includes people who are homeless, living in shelters, up to a congressman and a general who was deployed overseas. And we had, including CEOs, and we had people all across the spectrum. Of course, 61, we don't have everyone in there. We don't have Barack Obama in there, but we had quite a good sample. So here's a quote from one of the participants. I'm a very hard worker. I think that speaks to the fact that I went from being a secretary to being a trainer and a support person to being a manager. Then you get laid off and you feel just helpless, and this is where I'm at right now. And here you can see the person's experience, their lived experience. And many of the people we met who talked about their experiences of losing their jobs were tearful. And my experience of doing therapy with long-term unemployed clients, which is my specialty, is that it's akin to losing a long-term relationship. I've had people come to see me at the height of the recession who literally cry throughout the entire session, multiple sessions in a row. So what I witnessed at the height of that recession, and I was seeing almost all long-term unemployed clients then, was, for me, really traumatizing. I remember at the end of the day, I would hold my head in my hands and think, how am I helping them? I mean, I provide comfort, but I couldn't give them jobs immediately, and it was very, very painful. Here are some of the sub-themes of centrality of work. Work is a source of personal fulfillment. This person talks about the capacity to achieve things, accomplishment, achievement. This is something I've seen a lot in this study. People feel in the sense of aliveness by accomplishing things. Those of us who are academics, the way we feel when we send an article in. Although I liked it better back in Albany when we sent them in. Julie will remember, we sent them in without, before the email, we would send in the manuscript. And then our faculty, we had a little style there, got it from Doug Stromer, that we would put a paper clip around each manuscript with a piece of paper under it so the paper clip rust would not affect the manuscript. It's a little OCD. For those were great experiences. Also, the centrality of working, defining identity. Critical issue. We talk about this a lot. I recently had an opportunity to write a white paper for the International Labor Organization on the contributions of psychology to the decent work agenda. They were most interested in this issue of identity. They're very concerned about what's going to happen with people's identities when there's not enough work. So I worked with two Swiss colleagues, and I could share this paper. In fact, that's one of the things we could post on the Work Sciences Center. This person actually was a very sad story. She was a nurse, and she said she got in with a bad crowd, and very quickly she became addicted to drugs in the late 90s and passed some bad checks. It was just like a brief downward spiral she had, was put in jail for a very brief period of time, and could never be a nurse again. So the substance abuse and jail history. And was working as a paralegal, interesting enough. It's okay to go with that. I don't need to say anything more about this. I could say more, but I don't know. It's very interesting that she felt that loss of identity. It was already like 15 years later. It was a gut-wrenching experience for her. Gut-wrenching experience. She wanted to be a nurse in the worst way. Next area I want to discuss is being able to survive and thrive. And at our core, the evolutionary core of our life experience as human beings is survival. And Howard and I were talking about the history of work, that so much of work, as we know, was focused around survival. Now, certainly in prehistoric periods, there was also art being created and crafts, but by and large, when people were in hunter-gatherer periods, they had to put a lot of work into surviving. So this is kind of like the core issue. It's kind of like when you cut away, you know, all of the accoutrements of our socialized life, that's kind of what I saw at the core with people who were struggling. The desperate need to survive. This next quote, oh, it's blown me away. This is an African-American woman we interviewed who was living in a shelter. This is amazing that she said this. She said, "I see work as a new form of modern slavery to me. I've been out of work for almost 2 years now, and right now I'm in desperate stuff. So I'm willing to be a slave, do whatever I need to do. You do whatever the employer tells you to do to keep the job." These were folks in shelters. This was in the middle of January. When they lived in shelters, they had to leave the shelter from 9 in the morning till 5 in the evening to look for a job. Now, that's a 1970s way of looking for a job. You'd go to the store and fill out an application. Reality was they had to go to the library and go online. They really needed to be indoors. They didn't have to hit the pavement. So it's very interesting. As far as survival goals, I don't usually like materialistic things, only for things I need, so that's what I use money for. And now my needs are so big because I've been homeless. These were amazing experiences. Another one here. You don't know when the next job is going to come around on the anxiety level. My anxiety level goes up substantially when I'm unemployed. And this person here, they do point out it's like losing a relationship. And I could attest to this, both experientially and based on this qualitative research data. Because when people now lose these stable jobs, people know now, especially if they're getting laid off from a field that is in a decline, they know that what awaits them is precarious work. The gig economy, if you go into Panera or Starbucks now, you see more middle-aged people working there. You see people who are saying they're retired early. How many of them would retire early in their 50s if they had a decent job that they could go to? The next chapter focused on being with others. This is the social connection part of the psychology of working. And the theme here was looking at relationships at work, and I named this after that movie, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly from the 1960s. I call it The Good, the Bad, and the In-Between. I use my pop cultural references here, like Julie, you'll be very happy with it. Well, the editor didn't want it, and I'll tell you what they did. Their office, in terms of using permissions, had this idea, what they call the free trade approach, which is they said I should pay the highest amount that I was paying for other permissions. I said, this is outrageous, bro. I've been following Bruce Springsteen since 1973. I helped to put it, I bought all his albums the day they came out. I didn't quite say that, but I wasn't thrilled with that approach. But that's the world we live in. This is an amazing, this is really a very moving one. This is another guy who was in jail, this time for driving under the influence, and I think he injured someone as well. I don't think he killed anyone. I didn't interview him, one of my students did, but this, I could not have written a more evocative description of what the relationships between, the connection between relationships and work. Bankruptcy. I felt like a failure in that I wasn't able to change and market myself well or adjust to the changes in the recording industry. He was a technician. There was an emotional and mental impact on me that hit me, and it happened to me at the same time my ex-wife was having an affair. He was married to her at the time. So the divorce was impending, the bankruptcy was impending, and my decision-making was deteriorating. And that's what led to my car accident and prison eventually. That was probably the darkest time of my life because all my identity, again, for me as a man, my identity is in my work, and you know, my marriage, and both of these things were falling, like my twin towers were falling apart. I went in and read this entire interview, and I read it again when I saw this. He was in New York, a native New Yorker. He was in Manhattan when the towers were hit. For him, the twin towers had a tremendously powerful metaphorical meaning for him. And this description, actually the way I write about it at the end of this chapter is that working relationships are kind of like the Twin Towers. Because actually I used to visit the Twin Towers when I was a messenger. One of my first jobs in college, before we had faxes, before we had email, they had messengers. And actually I liked the job because they would send, and my brother had the job too, they would send us out to go to another part of New York. And we lived in Queens. We discovered Manhattan that way. And we would sit there and read the Village Voice. Maybe we wouldn't go back so fast. Have great lunches. It was a very nice job. But I do remember going to the Twin Towers in 1971, 72, before they were done. So the way I describe it is these towers are up, they were vulnerable, but there was a base connecting them at the bottom. I don't know if you've ever been there. There was a base connecting them where there was some stores and subway stations. So I talk about how relationships at work, we're vulnerable in both areas of our lives, but there's a base, the core of us connects both of these areas of vulnerability. So it's like my little metaphor based on this guy's metaphor. Another aspect of being with others is internalizations. This is a guy I interviewed who was in his 40s, higher ed professional, African-American guy, grew up in a family, and was very accomplished in his profession. His mother was a crack addict, and he grew up in a crack-filled 1980s LA urban community, and was able to get his way out. I mean, these are amazing stories that he got his way out and had a PhD, was really high functioning, really well regarded colleague. So he talks about what helped him. He was in a program called Educational Equal Opportunity Programs for students who are either first generation college students or low income. And he found somebody who believed in him. And as he talked about him, he basically was able to internalize this soothing object, this soothing, the comforting aspects of him. The next chapter is being part of something bigger than ourselves, and I have to give my parents credit for this one. My mom worked in a department store, Mays Department Store, not Macy's, kind of a blue-collar department store. My father was a sheet metal mechanic at Pan Am. And I might have said something snarky at some point. I don't imagine I ever did, but I might have. Because I just remember saying, we don't have glamorous jobs, but we have dignity in our work. And I remember my mother saying that to me when I was like 11 or 12 years old. So if you want to know how I became a vocational psychologist, maybe it was that moment. And what she said was, your father and I, we believe in what we do. And my mother said, I like helping people pick out makeup. And the women in our neighborhood can't afford a lot, so I helped them find makeup that's inexpensive, and she loved doing that. And my father loved aviation. He wanted to be a pilot, couldn't be a pilot, so he was a metal worker. He was fixing the fuselages and the tray tables. So they had these jobs that they were not glamorous, but they had jobs that meant something and that mattered. So here, this person talks about how work to me is a vehicle for how people connect their talents to the world. I guess that's how I see work, is how we get things done. This is another colleague of mine who's a career counselor, African-American colleague. It's how we translate as a society, as a world, our skills, our abilities and values into action, to making things happen. Somehow the rest of the slide is missing. Also, being part of something bigger than ourselves, contributing to the social good. This was a social worker who talked about the importance of helping people. And then this issue, I was talking with somebody earlier today about finding meaning in a meaningless job. This was a person who struggled with it. This person worked in a call center. And she was miserable. She had absolutely no meaning in her job. She actually said in her interview, she had a stomach virus the day before we interviewed her. She was sick as a dog, and she preferred that than going to work. Now, we've all had stomach viruses, and I'm the worst patient for a stomach virus, so I can't imagine how she could say that she would have rather been sick like that than go to work, but that's how much she found her job so meaningless. Then I discussed the issues of motivation. Actually, Ruth's work was very informative. I actually wrote to you when I was working on this chapter, and you sent me some of your work. So what motivates people to work? These are the kind of questions I wondered about. With so much knowledge on work motivation and idle psychology, when I read your articles, I thought, how am I going to make any kind of contribution to that? And I thought the only way to do it is to see what the participants have to say. Because the literature of the area is very extensive and very, very interesting. So these are some of the questions that I wondered about, especially how the scarcity of decent work affects motivation. So here's somebody who talks about who's had some precarious work. I've been through times when I'm not working, when I'm really struggling, and those times when I was not working, I was not creating value. These were the times when I was really depressed. And I just don't want to feel that way again. I want to feel that I have creative value in life, that I'm not just existing, but I'm living my life. Here's a discussion of intrinsic motivation. And this was a guy we interviewed who was a full-time magician. That was very unusual. Made his living as a magician. Actually, Ivy League trained young man. Was working as a magician and making a living at it. And it was very interesting, but listen to how he describes his experience. he described it like having a runner's high, preparing for the magic show. It was an area I could not relate to because I'm not super interested in magic. And I just can't imagine, I don't know if I'm the only one, but like I wouldn't seek out a magic show. Julie, would you seek out a,
no?
You would not, so.
This doesn't seem very different from a hedge fund trader, though. They spin magical ideas too, right?
And then they probably get this runner's high from manipulating all these funds and.
And people.
And people, right?
It's a very creative, very creative.
Description.
Effort to do this.
Actually, it is.
It takes enormous intelligence and skill.
It does. You know something about magic.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, so thank you for sharing that, because actually I know it does. And I know this guy is actually the partner of one of our doc students. And
plus it has a very deep history.
It does.
The people who do magic don't know this history.
Yeah, he's a scholar.
They know all the tricks, as I say.
So maybe we should give it, Julie, we have to give this another try. We have to get more of an intellectual perspective on it, and then we'll go back. The next chapter was being able to care. I've been very influenced by the work of Mary Sue Richardson. She was a mentor to me earlier in my life, a professor at NYU in psychology. She wrote a seminal article in 1983 on work as a location for counseling psychologists. Really, it's an article that it's a very important article for the Work Scientist, and it was an article that brought a lot of vocational psychologists back to work. Really important paper. And in that article, which is already 20-some-odd years old, she talks about the importance of caregiving and how the male hegemony of counseling psychology and vocational psychology is completely diminished. Any kind of focus or interest in caregiving or legitimization of caregiving. And even though I wrote a lot about it in my 2006 book, she critiqued me. I didn't write enough about it. And I took the critique seriously because I take her so seriously. And I went out this summer working on this chapter. I read multiple books on caregiving. I read a book by Nancy Fulbright on caregiving from an economics perspective. I read a book by an Israeli psychologist on the caring motivation. So I really did a deep dive into this. One of the issues that I wanted to talk about is how can we optimize caregiving for a future when opportunities for marketplace work when they may be diminishing. This is a little weird here. How did this happen? Well, it might be the translation from one computer to another. The picture shouldn't be where the words are. caring and caregiving are very human aspects of our lives. We all have, according to John Bowlby in the attachment theory, the underreported part of attachment theory is that adults have caregiving, we have caregiving tendencies the same way infants have a desire to be cared for. Without adults having the caregiving predilection, we wouldn't survive. It had to be a two-way operation. And that caregiving is still part of who we are. And the question that comes up is, should we incorporate caregiving work into such proposals as a guaranteed basic income? And I will discuss this a little bit more at the end. So there's a very rich literature on this issue, and just as an example here, here's a description of, I think caregiving is very important. This actually is from my brother who passed away this past spring. He gave me permission. He was one of my participants. He also said to me I could publicly use his example. He had a very hard work life, and I don't want to go into a lot of detail on it, but he did, when he contracted multiple myeloma, he couldn't work anymore. And what he did was he got involved with a support group, and he was not a support group kind of guy. I was the therapist type of the family. He was definitely not. So he actually got involved with a support group in his community, but he became an expert in financial advice. He learned that, and this is actually quite an interesting what he learned, is that when you have a blood cancer, no matter what it is, the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society will cover almost all of your medical expenses. Thousands of dollars, actually. Co-payments. And he actually developed PowerPoint slides and gave these lectures, did them on webinars. What he wrote here is very moving. He said, he knows that I've saved people a lot of money. I think it's the most important work I've ever done in my life. I was so moved when he told me this. This was before I knew he was going to die when he did. So He's actually, I hope you won't read the book, but there's a lot of excerpts to him. I will be using his name, because as I said, he wanted me to do that. But he did tell me something amazing. He got laid off in 2002, and he told me the day he got laid off was the most horrific experience. The analogy is like they have that that poem that was the German poet wrote about how people came for the Jews and they came for the gays and they came for the Seventh-day Adventists. So my brother knew there was going to be a layoff. He was a computer programmer, and he didn't think he was going to be laid off. He knew there'd be a big layoff, and then because his manager was friendly with him and said, "Oh, you folks will not be laid off." Then he saw the police coming for each person. And then they came for him, and he told me that the day he got laid off was even worse than the day he got his cancer diagnosis. Now that speaks volumes about the loss of work. In much respect, I don't think it was, but we lost him. So work is one of the, working without oppression and harassment. I wrote a very long chapter on this. My editor may not like how long it is, but I ended up really diving into these issues. They're very important to me. Work can give us enormous sense of accomplishment. However, work is also the social theater of our lives. It's a place where we interact with people, especially interact with people who are outside of our own communities. And that's the place where we can experience the most oppression and marginalization. So we know that poverty is intertwined with race in the U.S., and these are just some of the data that we all need to really remember, that, that racism is still very much alive in the workforce. These are the ways in which racism is manifested. So here, in response to the American Dream question, one of our participants said this. The question was, do you believe in the American Dream? The person said, I think if you're white, that's true. I don't believe that it's true if you're a person of color. I don't think it's true if you're an African American. I know there are a lot of barriers, there are a lot of stresses, but I know that it is not a reality. It's not a reality for everyone. Here's another participant, talks about race and ethnicity. And this person talks about, when we interviewed them, they had post-traumatic flashbacks. It's quite profound. Actually, I interviewed this guy. He was a Latino guy who was in the banking business, was laid off at the height of the recession, and he discovered himself as a career coach. But all these kinds of new jobs sound good in theory, but he couldn't make a living. He was hit or miss. So he said he had interviewed 11 times for a job that he knew he had the skills to get. And he had the numbers, he was very competent in what he did. And gender at work, I spent a lot of time on this as well. This is an individual, a woman who became a social worker, who actually had a lot of interest in STEM areas, and her whole family were engineers. And she talks about how she just, even though she had this kind of culture of engineering, this culture of STEM in her life, that gender impacted her decision. So teacher, social worker, nurse, these were the options open to me. So being without work, the issues of being without work are very complex. We've talked about this churning issue. What is full employment? Right now, the people say we have 4.1% unemployment. It's full employment. What the labor, what the statistics don't talk about is the labor market participation rate, which since 2007 has gone down 3 percentage points. This is the real statistic about workforce productivity and accessibility. So there's 3% less people in the labor market now than there were 10 years ago. So the unemployment rate really is a very kind of misleading statistic. And I know politicians of all stripes want to see those numbers come down. And certainly as a person who was supporting the Clinton administration, I wanted to see those numbers come down before the election. So we know that there's some complexity here. We also know that unemployment is a major causal factor in mental health problems. Research literature is very compelling on this. Classic meta-analysis by Paul and Moser from 2009 demonstrates it so compellingly. So unemployment, underemployment, precarious work, these have become the central story about working. Here's a person describing their experience. This is an individual who is a really powerful story. This person is talking about how he wants to live a purpose-filled life. Went to an Ivy League undergrad school, Ivy League MBA program, and was laid off 4 times in 15 years. And he says here that he says, I realize that most people live in lives of quiet desperation and being terribly unhappy with their work choices or what's available to them. So let me talk about some of the trends. I know I have a few minutes left, but I want to talk about some of the main themes from the book and then some of the implications. So some of the main themes I talk about in the last chapter are the psychological experiences of work. And I tried to summarize them, but in a nutshell, people were really in pain. Some people were feeling okay, but even those who were feeling okay were seeing kind of a devastation around them and did not feel completely safe or secure. Then there's this issue of sustainable livelihoods and working. And this is going to be one of my implications, which I'll touch on in a second, which is that people connect the capacity to sustain themselves with work. So we often talk about work for meaning, work for purpose, but work is integrally related to our ability to survive. It's a very complex aspect of human life. It fulfills critical economic needs as well as psychological, social needs. This is a critical finding for us, the social and psychological erosion of the workplace. And this was very compelling, and actually this came up in discussions with my research team. And I give them credit for this. That what we saw in these interviews as we looked at them collectively was this eroding workplace. For people who didn't have work and for people who did have work, the erosion was manifested in greater sexism, greater discrimination, marginalization, increase in bullying. In some ways, as work became more precarious, it became easier for bullies to be bullies because people couldn't fight back and people couldn't quit jobs as easily. It's a big problem. The issue of assessing causality in the workplace, a very important issue from a psychological perspective. One of my good friends, Ofer Sharon, is an occupational sociologist, dear friend of mine, and he and I have done some work with long-term unemployed professionals in the Boston area. He did a brilliant book in 2014 called Flawed Systems, Flawed Selves, where he compared long-term unemployed Israelis and Americans. Very intriguing study. You would think they'd be very similar cultures in some ways. Interestingly, no. The American unemployed people tend to blame themselves. It's again a very large qualitative sample, 160 like in each country. The Israelis blame the system. And in part they blame the system, I think, because they feel like the system owes them something because of all their military service. Whereas the Americans were deep into self-blame, and he's followed this up with a study of what career counselors and career coaches are doing with long-term unemployed and doing content analyses of their sessions. And here again, they see this pervasive self-blame quality. And I saw it in my study as well. So this is a very important aspect. And my analysis of it is a manifestation of the individualistic ethos in the United States. We're responsible for our successes and we're responsible for our failures. And I think what I wrote in the book is they take more credit for their successes oftentimes. We have a president who's a great expert in that. Not that there aren't many successes. But people also are blaming themselves more. So another major theme is these two very disparate experiences of working. Working for survival and working for self-determination. Very different experiences, and what I saw in the data is that people are cycling back and forth between the two. And the idea of people going in a linear way from kind of working in survival jobs to increasing their skills and getting into self-determination kinds of careers, that's starting to erode as well. So some of the caveats here, we did see in some cases the people who were, you know, kind of not allowed back into their self-determination work lives, did find meaning, but often they had financial resources. And that was one of the findings from an unemployment study that I did in 2013. implications for career development practice. What I argue here is that we need to expand and we need to change our paradigms. And what's the nature of this changing paradigm? I think the changing paradigm is going to need to be one where people are not going to always have access to meaningful, decent work and dignified work. And I will talk briefly about what I think we could do about that. So that one of the examples of the new paradigms obviously would be I found myself in class saying that word over and over again, and then I said to my students, I said, I'm repeating this word too much. So I acknowledge it. So theoretically, it could be the psychology of working theory and framework. And in this, we've proposed to focus on the full spectrum of people who work, including those with less than optimal choice and volition. So let me talk about some of the individual implications in terms of implications for people that I think about, readers who will look at this book and wonder what can they learn about themselves? What is the impact of work? One of them is this enormous unpredictability about work. Another one is inequality. Talked about this at one of the meetings I had earlier. And the inequality issue was prevalent for people. They were very much aware of it. And then this issue of what happens to dreams deferred or dashed. Implications for communities. I've written about how there's a need for much better career services, career counseling, job seeking help. The United States has one of the least efficient and least effective career services outside of higher education in the industrialized world. I've traveled a lot in Europe, been very fortunate. I've seen in relatively poor countries like Portugal, wealthier countries like Italy and France, Switzerland, extensive services given to people across the lifespan, including psychologists providing assessments, supportive counseling. And thanks to our neoliberal President Reagan, who really began the neoliberal movement, he was the one who, of course, privatized what used to be called the job service and said it could be done better locally. Now, in Boston, we've got great ones, but they're not consistent across the country. We also need improved lifelong learning opportunities. Tom Friedman wrote about this in his most recent book. Very big issue. And this is one of the things that I think is a big problem in looking at the Trump election. Some of the reasons why people voted for Trump were because they felt like they had no other opportunities. And what do we offer them as psychologists, as counselors? STEM, coding. More STEM, more coding. What are you telling people who didn't do well in school? Go back to school. Remember when you were in school and the kids weren't doing well there, and how were they? They were so shamed and humiliated. Get somebody to go back to school where they got Fs and Cs and Ds. So those are very difficult situations. I also think an intentional social contract needs to be established that underscores the importance of supporting all those who work and who want to work. So in terms of, I only have a few minutes left, public policy implications. Human rights and working, I underscore the UN Declaration of Human Rights, which in the late 1940s did advocate for work for everyone. I also underscore the ILO's Decent Work Agenda. And both of these things are well regarded by scholars, by people working for NGOs. They're not really internalized in many of the neoliberal economies, neoliberal policies. I have a few colleagues in Europe who just edited a book on neoliberal, a critique of neoliberalism and career guidance. I actually was invited to do a chapter, but I gave it to one of my students because of this book. But there's an emerging critique, especially among my European colleagues, that neoliberal policies are devastating the workforce. And what the neoliberal policies have done is basically liberalize the regulations for the corporate state. So actually, I was watching the news last night on the way down here, and they were talking about how Mitch McConnell is aligning himself with Trump because he wants to dismantle the Obama regulatory state. Well, the Obama regulatory state, which goes back to Franklin Roosevelt, was designed to create a more humane form of capitalism. So when you're trying to reduce these regulations, you're liberalizing this, these kinds of harsh edges of capitalism. And as some of the main scholars in precarious work, Caliber, Steve Vallis, have written, what's happened in the last 40 years is we've shifted the burden of risk from employers to employees. And when you reduce these regulations, you reduce these kind of these policies that protect workers, you're providing less of a risk for entrepreneurs and a more of a risk for workers. And in my book, we saw the consequences of it. This is a very important issue. Unpacking work from sustainability. Work, as we get to a point where, and I, maybe the next time I come here, I could talk about, give my future of work presentation. If we look at a period of time when work is less available, people are going to need to have basic income guarantees. People in Silicon Valley are talking about it now. But you have to be careful when you look at these, because these recommendations often come from libertarian right-wingers. And their view on this, this is what I've heard this more from my European colleagues, is that there would be lump sum payments to people that would obviate the state from having to provide tuition support, free schools, free medical care. People would just get a lump sum for their lives from the state. And my colleagues in Germany in particular were talking extensively about the risks of going wholly into this basic income guarantees. The other view in Europe, and the big debate is, the guaranteed income, that even the wealthy would get the same income guarantees, which, because they say that it's humiliating to go through means testing. I think it'd be humiliating to give Donald Trump an income guarantee. So I'll go through means testing. I'll show them my income tax returns. What the heck? It's fair. Education and work in an age of uncertainty. This is a new research direction for me and another colleague at Boston College. What's going to happen to the narrative of K through 16 education if we can no longer tell our students, you need to study hard because you'll get a good job? How do, and no one in education is talking about this. At a conference I'm going to be at next week on technology and jobs, there is a speaker on it, so I'm looking forward to seeing what that person says, because my colleague, who's a top scholar in education, says there's no conversation about what the educational narrative will be if in 10 years there's 20%. It may not be unemployment because people will have gig jobs. So they won't come out on the unemployment, but they'll be driving for Lyft or renting their homes out. And good piece of research is how many people driving for Lyft and Airbnb rentals really want to do that? Some people, like my stepdaughters, they love Airbnbs, they want to meet new people. When I come home at night, I don't want to have a new person come in every night. You got to be up, you got to be on your game. You can't get in your pajamas till you go to sleep. I'm just trying to get the texture of this. So, just some final points. We need to develop a humane policies about working. When I finish this book, one of my goals is going to be to write an op-ed piece. Easier to write an op-ed piece than to get it published, of course, but I will try to write one. In my view, our society can create sufficient jobs. There's many jobs that need to be done. Well, I was talking to somebody earlier that instead of having 30 people in a classroom, who said this? We could have 10 people in a classroom. We could triple the number of teachers, triple the number of therapists. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. Roosevelt showed us how to do it. Having the government create work should not be seen as a kind of anathema, but it should be seen as a real resource in our country. The ILO's decent work agenda, which you should all read, it's a very detailed agenda, should be incorporated into our policies about working, and a work-based safety net is needed for all. So let me just move on from here. I have more details here, but I want to give you guys a chance to ask me some questions. So I was really moved by working on this project, and I hope I was able to convey some of my emotional, the intensity of my own experience of doing this with you. So thank you very much, but I would love to take some questions. Now I know we have a reception, so maybe at least 5 or 10 minutes of questions. Is that okay? Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Question?
Yes.
So you mentioned ageism in one of your slides, but I recall hearing one of your interviews roughly around 2010, so we were pretty deeply into the Great Recession. People reporting how impossible it was if you were older and laid off to find work. And of course, we have a lot of laws in the system that prevent you from being terminated solely because of your age. But it's very difficult to prove that there's discrimination against you based on how old you are when you are not hired for a job, especially when there are very, very few jobs. You talk a lot about the age distribution in your sample, but I'm wondering if a lot of these people were, in fact, the ones that were experiencing the most sense of dislocation and despair, were, as was implied in one of your slides, individuals who've been working for a long time, found themselves laid off, and then the long-term unemployment might be a derivative consequence of being in their 50s or 60s.
Very good point.
Being regarded as being hireable by typical management.
That's an excellent point, and actually, it's interesting, I didn't get a lot of, we didn't ask about age, and we didn't get a lot of unsolicited comments about it, but statistically, yes, we had a number of pockets of these sample of people who were long-term unemployed, many in their 50s and 60s, but we also had a fair number who were in their 20s and 30s, often folks of color or immigrants who were really on the margins, really kind of leading marginal lives. The issue of age, I'll just share with you one quick story. When Ofer Sharon contacted me about joining up with his group, Institute for Career Transitions, and you know, it basically involved me doing some pro bono work with long-term unemployed, and I said to him, you know, Ofer, my thing is really the blue-collar worker and the poor. He said, David, let me tell you something. The percentage of people in their 50s and 60s who are not working in stable, decent jobs is the same as it is for blue-collar. It's actually higher than it is for the same age group of people who have blue-collar jobs, because it's easier to get back into a blue-collar job than it is to get back into a white-collar management job. So there has been a devastation among workers in who are 50s in there, in the 50s and 60s. Actually, Ofer and some of his colleagues have done audit studies. It's interesting that economists call these experimental designs audit studies. But they send off resumes with differences, slight differences in age, or they also change the name of the gender, or the name of the applicant. And they found that there was a six time, people who were like in their 30s were six times more likely to get called in for an interview than the same exact resume for somebody who was in their mid-50s. What companies will say is they're not involved with age discrimination, but they'll often say that they'll hire the younger worker because they're more technologically savvy. So that's one of the ways in which ageism is being manifested, but it's a huge crisis in this country. Obama did have a conference on long-term unemployment in 2014. In fact, my friend Ofer was invited to it. And he had a lot of the big employers there, and he leaned on them to make changes. But, you know, we're in a deregulatory state, so it's not a lot we can do. And I think part of the issue is that younger workers will work 14, 15 hours a day. And it's been a big, big problem. So, yeah, in the study, I did see this, we did observe this a lot. Yes?
So one of the things that was really interesting about your talk is you talked about the two twin towers of interpersonal relationships and work. And I was wondering if in the people that you talked with that were long-term unemployed, imagine, as you said, that there's a large group that were depressed as a result, but I would imagine maybe, I was curious if there were any that weren't, and if maybe they had kind of shifted the meaning in their life toward these interpersonal relationships, like, oh, work is not as important, I have this, assuming that they had their basic needs met, maybe in some other way with social support, or. So I guess, more succinct, my question is, did you notice a shifting of, in your interviews, of what people valued as meaningful if they were unable to find work and were not depressed?
It's a great question. actually, in a previous study I did on unemployment, I did a qualitative study and we submitted it to JBB. Actually, before we submitted it, I now have enough experience to know that, okay, I was talking to my students, I said, it's a good study, but there's nothing new in it. They're not gonna publish it in JBB, we just say unemployment's bad. But what we found in there, which was disconcerting to me, was a small sample of 13, about half the people seemed to be doing okay. not just okay, some of them were happy that they weren't working. But each of those people, and it was about six of them, had financial resources. They unpacked sustainability from their work lives. And they created different kinds of meaningful projects in their lives. One of them was managing a jazz band, someone else was taking up art. And these were not just, they were deeply engaged in these projects. They were not just kind of superficial things to keep themselves busy. So when people, when their sustainability and survival needs are met, people do have an opportunity to develop meaningful projects. I think the task is going to be for us as psychologists, counselors, and others, how do we help people find meaning in their lives, and how do we ensure that this guaranteed income allocations are not going to be seen as welfare payments and will not create an even more unequal society, and that's going to be a big challenge. But I could tell you, the United States will not be the first one into the basic income guarantee world. Yes?
So I'm trying to reconcile a couple of different scenarios here, and I understand what you're saying about the meaning of work, but I'm also thinking about how that translates to people who are students, adults who are students. So a 20 or 25-year-old individual who's a student, they don't look at their current experiences necessarily as a job, even though they may be working as a teaching assistant or research assistant or something like that. And the reason I'm wondering about that is that if the federal government has been involved and state governments have been involved in providing retraining for structural unemployment for at least 60, 70 years in varying guises. And they do that partly by providing educational and retraining opportunities. The people that you talk to worked in the middle of those educational or training opportunities, but if they were, what do you say about where they get their meaning from, if they're students or they're retrained?
I think that engaging in training and education is very meaningful.
Then why don't more people do it?
Great question. I think one of the answers is that there are a cohort of people in our country who did well in school, who liked school, for whom school was a comfortable place, and they would gladly do it. The people who've been caught up in the deindustrialization and the loss of factory jobs often were not the top students. And we tell them, okay, go back.
I get that, but I'm talking about your blue-collar workers. And you can see that in recent stories about the retraining and re-education opportunities for people who are living in coal mining country. They're not signing up for these classes. Now, some of them are saying, it's not going to provide me the kind of salary that I used to get when I was a coal miner. But others that's your sustenance and your survival part of that. But it's if you get meaning from the retraining, you should be more oriented towards that, even if it's not providing a lot.
How do we know they get meaning from the retraining?
That's what I just asked you.
Yeah, I don't know. We don't know.
Okay.
Well, we have to design, are we designing training that's going to be maximally meaningful? I still go back to my point, which is the people who fell for the idea that we're going to bring back factory jobs that pay $80,000 a year were people who basically just wanted those jobs back. They were kind of the people, and I don't know, I tend to be a contextual thinker in my work. I don't blame it on them. I blame it on educational systems that didn't help them look at different learning styles, that didn't help them find meaning in their own experience of learning.
Well,
so why do they go back to a place where they've been humiliated?
But if that's the case, then it's not clear to me that any of those other issues that you talked about in terms of things other than pay are important. If you say, I'm only going to go take this training if I can get an $80,000 a year job, then all the other things that you talked about, the meaning from having collaborators and coworkers and doing worthwhile work, none of that stuff matters. That the only thing that matters is making $80,000 a year.
Well, I think when you're the way I would interpret that question is when you're at a point where you're trying to sustain yourself, the survival needs become the preeminent. They become the dominant experience. So they over when you're not your survival needs aren't met, they overrule your other needs.
So you're taking a Maslow perspective.
Basically a Maslowian perspective on that I think survival needs are preeminent.
Raise a similar issue mean, you touched on this, but it's easy to see that most people's jobs have nothing to do with achievement or realizing goals or all these other things. It has to do with survival. I mean, many people have more than one job, for example, and they have to have more than one job in order to be able to live. So that seems to be the number one process. I mean, I don't think anyone would aspire to be a Waffle House waitress or a whole host of other similar jobs. That seems to be the baseline against which everything else has to be assessed, whether it's training or anything else. But, I mean, these people are leading lives of not necessarily so quiet desperation.
Or, you know, well, there are some who also do find meaning in their work. I think we spoke about this earlier. You talked about the postal worker here on this campus.
Right, and in the class I teach in the honors program on purposeful work and asking the students, do they think that the people who sell us stamps and ship their packages and in the student center consider their work meaningful, enjoy their work, and the Georgia Tech students say, well, I can't imagine, it must be really boring. I guess they just do it because they're not educated, they don't have any other choices. And then I gave an example of some interactions with the woman that we probably, many of us dealt with there, who's always extremely helpful and friendly, and a particular example I gave, and then I said, do you think that she maybe finds meaning in her work? And they, I mean, obviously I was leading them to think that, but they then said, oh, okay, I see. So maybe for her, this isn't the only thing she could do. It is meaningful work for her. She's happy to have the job kind of perspective.
I think that you can, it's all too easy to put our own perspectives on other people's lives. Mm-hmm. I don't know how people, I know what provides meaning for me, potentially. I'm not willing to make judgments about what other people think is meaningful or not. But to Phil's point, I think that, you know, your point about why people go get training if it has meaning and so on, there's one thing that comes across here that overlays the decision-making that's involved in engaging in that path, and that's the desperation,
right,
and the stress and the anxiety and the uncertainty and the fear of the future that is the lives of these people. And so when they're in this level of desperation where they've lost their jobs, coal mining is going away, it's never coming back, I don't know what I'm going to do, it's not easy to make rational decisions like, well, maybe I'll get meaning out of learning and becoming a student. That might be the best way.
Yeah, the rational part of it
is hard to do that.
That's very good. I was thinking about that we is, you're assuming a level of rationality that may not be. It may not be.
No, I don't think it's about rationality. I mean, I think that two things. One is that I expect that there's just as much variance in perceived meaningfulness of a job among postal workers as there is among professors. I don't think that. I mean, there may be a mean difference, but I suspect the variance is quite high, because I can look at my colleagues on any given day and they will tell you that half of what they do is not meaningful, right, or maybe more of it, depending on whether they're facing a pile of papers to grade or an endless series of meetings to go to. But I think that, no, to the original issue, I think it has more to do with maybe overemphasizing these other issues that you've been talking about. I think that it's not just survival. A lot of the reason why people who were well-paid blue-collar workers are not seeking training is because they have a lifestyle that they want to keep, and they can't see how to bridge that gap.
That's a very good point.
Okay?
Yeah.
After this last great recession, you know, there were people who were making six-figure salaries who said, well, if I can't find another white-collar managerial job, you know, screw it, that's the end of it. And there are other ones that, you know, you read about on the news who said, look, I'm willing to go work at Walmart. I'm willing to deliver Domino's pizzas. I'm willing to do whatever work I need to do in order to survive. My lifestyle is going to change. My standard of living is going to change. But I will survive on that basis. And I could, in turn, get meaning from that.
but other people can't see it.
Yes, a lot of individual differences. Yes.
Nope, I'm gonna take the discussion into the reception. I want to thank you again. Interesting questions. So there's a reception just outside.